On behalf of the Norwegian Academy of Science and Letters, it is a pleasure to welcome you to the announcement of the Abel Prize for 2009. My name is Tom Lyche. I am the chairman of the group of mathematicians in the Academy. The president of the Academy, Professor Øyvind Østerud, and the chairman of the Abel Committee, Kristian Seip, are now on their way to this room. They have been to a board meeting, and the president will announce the winner of the 2009 Abel Prize. After the official announcement, Kristian Seip will present the committee's citations. Then Vagn Lundsgaard Hansen, professor at the Technical University of Denmark, will give a popular presentation of the prize winner's life and work.
Det norske vitenskapsakademi har besluttet at Abelprisen 2009 tildeles Mikhail Leonidovich Gromov. The Norwegian Academy of Science and Letters has decided to award the Abel Prize for 2009 to Mikhail Leonidovich Gromov. Abel-komiteens formann, Kristian Seip, vil nå fremføre komiteens begrunnelse. The chairman of the Abel Committee, Kristian Seip, will now give the committee's citation. Please.
Presses, ladies and gentlemen, the 2009 Abel Prize is awarded to Mikhail Gromov for his revolutionary contributions to geometry. Geometry is one of the oldest fields of mathematics. It has engaged the attention of great mathematicians through the centuries, but underwent revolutionary change during the last 50 years. Mikhail Gromov has led some of the most important developments, producing profoundly original general ideas, which have resulted in new perspectives on geometry and other areas of mathematics. Riemannian geometry developed from the study of curved surfaces and their higher dimensional analogues, and has found applications, for instance, to the theory of general relativity. Gromov played a decisive role in the creation of modern global Riemannian geometry. His solutions of important problems in global geometry relied on new general concepts, such as convergence of Riemannian manifolds and the compactness principle, which now bear his name. Gromov is one of the founders of the field of global symplectic geometry. Holomorphic curves were known to be an important tool in the geometry of complex manifolds. However, the environment of integrable complex structures was too rigid. In a famous paper in 1985, he extended the concept of holomorphic curves to J-holomorphic curves on symplectic manifolds. This led to the theory of Gromov-Witten invariance, which is now an extremely active subject linked to modern quantum field theory. It also led to the creation of symplectic topology and gradually penetrated and transformed many other areas of mathematics. Gromov's work on groups of polynomial growth introduced ideas that forever changed the way in which a discrete infinite group is viewed. He discovered the geometry of discrete groups and solved several outstanding problems. His geometrical approach rendered complicated combinatorial arguments much more natural and powerful. Mikhail Gromov is always in pursuit of new questions and is constantly thinking of new ideas for solutions of long-standing problems. He has produced deep and original work throughout his career and remains remarkably creative. The work of Gromov will continue to be a source of inspiration for many future mathematical discoveries.
Professor Vagn Lundsgaard Hansen will now give a popular presentation of the prize winner. Afterwards, he will have an interview on the telephone.
Dear Academy members, ladies and gentlemen, Mikhail Gromov was born in 1943 in Russia. He studied and taught at the University of St. Petersburg, where he obtained his PhD in 1969 and wrote his postdoctoral thesis in 1973. In 1974, Gromov immigrated from Russia. Since 1982, he has been a permanent professor at the Institut des Etudes Scientifiques in France and Jay Gould Professor of Mathematics at New York University. He became a naturalized French citizen in 1992. Let me start the presentation of the work of Mikhail Gromov by a quotation from a speech in 1999 where he clearly formulates his views of mathematics. "The task of mathematics and mathematicians is to articulate the visible regularities in the physical and mental worlds and to find new structural patterns unperceivable by direct intuition and common sense." If a single fundamental mathematical concept should be mentioned as central in the work of Gromov, it is the notion of distance, which he has introduced in completely surprising situation and exploited with elegance. The notion of distance is used to measure whether two physical objects, two states of a physical or biological system, or two abstract ideas are mutually close or far apart. A mathematician will speak of an abstract space of the objects in question, called points in this connection, and will think of the distance as a particular assignment of a positive number to each pair of points in the space. Familiar situations deal with ordinary three-dimensional Euclidean space, where the distance between two points is given by the length of the straight line segment between them. For the inhabitants in a mountain country, this distance is only a modest practical value. A more useful distance in this case is given by the length of the shortest available path between two given locations. It's not surprising that a geometrical object such as a surface in three space can have a notion of distance associated to it, so that one can speak of the distance between any two points in the object. If the distance satisfies a few natural conditions, we say that it is a metric in the object and that the object has structure as a metric space. There are many other contexts where a collection of points can be equipped with a metric and thereby can be viewed as a metric space. An abstract example comes from the mathematical model of colors. In the so-called RGB decimal code, every color is characterized by a triplet of integers in the range 0 to 255. The first integer determines the amount of red, the second the amount of green, and the third integer the amount of blue. Accordingly, the code for red is given by 255.00, the code for green by 0255.0, and the code for blue by 00255. Using the RGB decimal code, we can organize the set of all colors in a space with 16,777,216 points. An appropriate definition of a distance between two colors could be the sum of absolute values of the differences between the three integers and the codes in the colors. With this definition or metric of the color space, the distance between red and blue is 510. In an arbitrary metric space M, Gromov shows that one can introduce a kind of product x dot y of any two points x and y in M with respect to a fixed reference point O in M. If dxy denotes the metric distance between x and y, then the product is defined by the formula shown in the slide, and it is now known as the Gromov product. Gromov uses his product to define the notion of a hyperbolic metric space by requiring that it satisfies the inequality, which is also shown in the slide. The inequality for hyperbolicity can be phrased in a more geometrical language using a suitably defined notion of triangles in the metric space. This type of metric space is known as a Gromov hyperbolic space. Hyperbolicity provides important global approaches to geometry and has also been applied in the context of group theory. Before we can proceed to describe some of the many contributions to mathematics by Gromov, we need to explain the notion of a manifold in some detail. In this connection, the notion of dimension is the first obstacle. The notion of dimension in mathematics is derived from the properties related to length, area, and volume, needing respectively 1, 2, and 3 parameters to be in play. Curves, surfaces, and solid bodies in ordinary three space are familiar examples of objects locally controlled by respectively 1, 2, and 3 parameters or coordinates, as we say. They are examples of manifolds of dimension 1, 2, and 3. In general, an n-dimensional manifold is a geometrical object in which the position of points in small pieces of the object are controlled by n parameters or coordinates. Surfaces in three space provide familiar examples of manifolds of dimension 2, the monkey saddle, the sphere, and a ring-shaped surface called a torus are shown in the slide. In higher dimensions, many interesting examples of manifolds occur as configuration spaces, that is, the possible positions, for mechanical systems. As a simple example, consider a planar double pendulum. The possible configurations of the double pendulum are determined by a pair of points on two circles, which in turn, this pair of points can be identified with a single point on a torus. The configuration space for a planar double pendulum is, in other words, a torus. If now instead we consider a double pendulum in free space, the possible configurations of this double pendulum are determined by a pair of points on two spheres. Hence, the configuration space for a spatial double pendulum can be identified with a four-dimensional manifold, namely the product of two spheres, in an Euclidean space of six dimensions. In more detail, an n-dimensional manifold, M, is a geometrical object which locally can be described by n parameters or coordinates. This entails that each point P in the object, M, has a neighborhood U in one-to-one correspondence with an n-dimensional cube of ordered n tuples x1 to xn of real numbers. In other words, the points x in the neighborhood u of p can each be assigned n coordinates. Such an identification of a neighborhood with a cube of ordered n tuples is called a local coordinate system on M. For a surface, there are two coordinates, x1, x2, in the local coordinate systems. Suppose now we have an n-dimensional manifold M. If we can cover M by a collection of local coordinate systems where exchange of coordinates in overlapping systems is smooth, that means differentiable, then it is called a smooth manifold. If the manifold M is even-dimensional, for example, it could have dimension 2, then the 2n real coordinates in a local coordinate system on M can be organized into n complex coordinates. For surfaces, it would be one complex coordinate. If the exchange of coordinates in overlapping local coordinate systems is holomorphic, that means differentiable in the complex sense, then the manifold is a complex manifold. The study of manifolds involves a local study of geometrical invariants and a global study of topological invariants. Geometrical invariants concern properties of manifolds preserved by isometric mappings, rigid motions, and topological invariants concern properties preserved by more flexible mappings called homeomorphisms or even by continuous deformations called homotopies. It has been said that a topologist is a mathematician who cannot tell the difference between a donut and a cup of coffee. During the last 50 years, investigations of the connections between the topology and the geometry of manifolds have received great attention in mathematics, with Gromov as a contributor of many brilliant new ideas. The notion of curvature is central in this context. Now, a smooth curve in a Euclidean plane has a natural concept of curvature attached to it. At each point P, the curve has a tangent line approximating the curve. This tangent line is, of course, not curved. However, the curve also has a circle that approximates it best possible in the neighborhood of P. This is the circle of curvature. The curvature kappa of the curve at a point P can then be defined as the reciprocal of the radius rho in the circle of curvature. If the plane has a preferred sense of rotation, and if the curve is traversed in a specified direction, then we can give the curvature a sign. The sign is plus one if the curve follows the preferred rotation in the neighborhood of P, and it's minus one if it follows the opposite orientation. Similarly, a smooth surface S in three-dimensional Euclidean space has a natural concept of curvature attached to it. At a point P in the surface S, consider all curves through P obtained by sectioning the surface with planes containing the normal line to the surface at P. The planar curves obtained by this sectioning process, called normal sections, all have a curvature. Giving the curvature of all normal sections a sign depending on the turning of the curve in relation to a normal of the surface, we define the notion of normal curvatures of the surface at P. One of these curvature is smallest possible, and one is largest possible. The product of the maximal and minimal normal curvatures we sign define the Gaussian curvature K, or, as we just say, the curvature of S at P. An intrinsic way of viewing curvature of a surface at a point P is to consider small geodesic triangles in the surface with a corner at P. A geodesic triangle in the surface is by definition a closed piece of surface with three points as corners and three curves of shortest lengths, geodesics, as sides. As already known to Gauss, the curvature of the surface S at P can be determined by taking an appropriate limit of the sum of the interior angles in infinitesimal geodesic triangles with a corner at P. The curvature is zero if this limit is exactly 180 degrees, like in ordinary plane geometry. It's negative if it's less than 180 degrees, and it's positive if it's greater than 180 degrees. A cylinder has curvature zero, a sphere has positive curvature, and the surface named the pseudosphere has negative curvature. In higher dimensions, a smooth manifold M often comes equipped with a metric tensor, a device by which you can measure lengths of curves and angles between curves in the manifold. Using the metric tensor, one can define surfaces of geodesic triangles in complete generality in such manifolds M and introduce a notion of sectional curvature corresponding to Gaussian curvature of the geodesic triangles. Smooth manifolds M equipped with a metric tensor are called Riemannian manifolds, and study of their geometry is Riemannian geometry. Gromov has made stunning contributions to Riemannian geometry, A particular contribution showing his daring imagination at its height is his definition of a natural metric structure on the set of all isomorphism classes of Riemannian manifolds. The definition of the metric exploits an idea of Hausdorff and is now known as the Gromov-Hausdorff distance between Riemannian manifolds. The distance organizes the set of isomorphism classes of Riemannian manifolds of all possible topological types into a single metric space in which convergence of Riemannian manifolds makes sense and allowing collapse of dimension. This unfolds a very rich geometry which has been exploited in the work of Gromov and several other eminent mathematicians. A spectacular result by Gromov in this area is his proof of estimates of the Betti numbers of Riemannian manifolds solely in terms of a lower bound on the sectional curvature. Betti numbers are important integers associated with the topology of a manifold. Symplectic geometry has its origins in the Hamiltonian formulation of classical mechanics, where the phase space of a mechanical system without friction has the structure of a symplectic manifold. Research in symplectic geometry has applications ranging from celestial mechanics to accelerator particle physics, solid body, and fluid mechanics. For systems with a finite number of degrees of freedom, the relevant space is an even-dimensional manifold, often called the phase space of the system. This manifold can, in a natural way, be given a so-called symplectic structure. The usefulness of this construct in studies of dynamical systems is the insight it provides about quantities conserved by time evolution. Geometrical mechanics has added tremendously to our insight into the deep workings of the mechanical universe. A classical example is provided by a system of three celestial bodies, say the Sun, the Earth, and the Moon. The system is driven by Newton's law of gravitation, where the future is determined by the positions and velocities of the three bodies at any given moment. In this case, the phase space of the system is a manifold of dimension 18, where each point in the manifold corresponds to a configuration of possible positions and velocities of the three bodies. Newton's laws can be encoded into a particular transformation of the phase space, where each point goes to a new point corresponding to the positions and velocities of the bodies after 1 second of motion. This transformation distorts any conceivable distance in the space and is very far from being a rigid motion. But it does preserve the symplectic structure, which is related to the area of surfaces in the phase space. However, it's not the usual area, and it's very difficult to give an intuitive picture of the symplectic structure. In general, a symplectic manifold is a smooth manifold M equipped with a symplectic form. This is a device by which you can measure surfaces area inside the manifold. Symplectic geometry is the study of symplectic manifolds. Symplectic geometry has a number of similarities and differences with Riemannian geometry. Unlike Riemannian manifolds, symplectic manifolds have no local invariants such as curvature. Another difference with Riemannian geometry is that not every differentiable manifold need admit a symplectic form. There are topological restrictions. For example, every symplectic manifold is necessarily of even dimension and it's orientable. Among the spheres of any dimension, only the two-dimensional sphere admits a symplectic form. An even-dimensional manifold M, which can be given a special type of complex structure turning it into a Kähler manifold, is also a symplectic manifold. A symplectic manifold of this type is said to have an integrable complex structure compatible with a symplectic form. Most symplectic manifolds are not of Kähler type, and hence they do not have an integrable complex structure compatible with a symplectic form. In a path-breaking work of 1985, Mikhail Gromov made the important observation that symplectic manifolds do admit plenty of compatible, almost complex doctors, and that they satisfy enough of the properties of Kähler manifolds to be useful. But exchanges of coordinates in the manifolds are not holomorphic, that is, complex differentiable, and therefore cleverness is required. Gromov has used the existence of almost complex structures on symplectic manifolds to develop a theory of pseudo-holomorphic curves, which are special maps of Riemann surfaces into almost complex manifolds. The highly original concept of pseudo-holomorphic curves has led to a number of advancements in symplectic topology, including a class of symplectic invariants now known as Gromov-Witten invariants, and they play a key role in string theory. Mikhail Gromov is also among the pioneers in using geometrical methods in group theory. In the early 1980s, he introduced and developed the notion of hyperbolic group, now known as a Gromov hyperbolic group. By definition, this is a finitely generated group equipped with a word metric satisfying certain properties characteristic of hyperbolic geometry. In a seminal paper of 1987, Gromov proposed a far-ranging research program for hyperbolic groups, which has inspired an entire generation of geometric group theorists. A spectacular highlight among the results of Gromov in geometric group theory is his proof of an old conjecture according to which a finitely generated group, a polynomial group, has a nilpotent subgroup of finite index. Mikhail Gromov has also made important contributions in analysis. He is known, among others, for having established a homotopy method to solve differential relations. It's now known as the H principle. This is a cornerstone in the foundations of a geometric theory of partial differential equations. This work was initiated in his doctoral dissertation of 1969, where Gromov found an astonishing new method by which he could generalize a number of immersion theorems for manifold. A well-known example of an inversion is provided by the image of the two-dimensional manifold known as the Klein bottle in three-dimensional Euclidean space. Theorems about immersions and embeddings were pioneered by Whitney in the mid-1930s and followed by important work of Smale and Hirsch in the late 1950s. In particular, Smale's proof that one can turn a sphere in Euclidean three space inside out through a smooth homotopy immersions struck the mathematical world with complete surprise. It came as a similar surprise to mathematicians when Gromov presented his elegant ideas on immersion theory. Special cases of his result were subsequently unfolded in works by other mathematicians. Not only in this connection, but in all of his work, one can say that Mikhail Gromov has turned the mathematical world inside out and shown us deep interrelations between mathematical concepts from many different mathematical fields. At the beginning of the new millennium, Mikhail Gromov stands out as one of the most creative mathematicians of our time. His work is unique and brings a profoundly original approach to the mathematical subjects he works with and often transcends his own field of geometry. He has created brilliant new concepts and devised elegant new techniques which have been applied to problems, some of which were long-standing and seemed to be inaccessible. Furthermore, several of the new techniques developed by Gromov for different purposes led to completely new kinds of problems. The creativity and originality of Mikhail Gromov as a mathematician rank at the level of Abel, and he deserves our warmest congratulations on receiving this prize dedicated to the memory of Abel. Thank you very much. And now the idea was that we should try to contact Gromov. But as we can see, Gromov is a very, very busy person, going around from country to country. And he exactly yesterday left Paris to go to New York. And so I suppose at this moment he has time lag or whatever it's called. And anyhow, he's sleeping. And so it's impossible to get hold of him. But I hope at another end I have a person who certainly knows a lot about Gromov. And this is Jean-Pierre Bourguignon, which is director of the Institut des Études Scientifiques, Bourg-sur-Yvette, near Paris in France. So I hope that you are there. Are you there, Jean-Pierre?
Hello, Vaughan. Well done your job. Oh, I'm here.
That's very good. So thank you. Yeah, I suppose now that you must be a very happy man.
I'm indeed a very happy man, but I've been a very happy man for many years because working with Misha has been really a great pleasure.
Yes.
And he's a fantastic supporter of the Institute in many senses of the word, that is, by his work, by his dedication, and by his inspiration.
Yes, okay, that's very nice. That's good to hear that he's a colleague who shares what he knows with all of you. And now maybe I would have, if I had Mikhail here, I would have asked him the following question. Maybe you have an idea. So I would have told him that he's a true cosmopolitan. He has worked at the University of St. Petersburg in Russia, and now he has positions in America and in France. And of course, those three countries here, they have very high traditions in mathematics. I wonder whether there are any similarities and differences between the three traditions. I suppose you should know something about all this also, Jean-Pierre. Are you there?
I'm there, yes. Well, it's very challenging in line to start discussing this issue. As you know, I mean, the Russian tradition in mathematics has been fantastic because of its breadth, and in particular, its fantastic connection between mathematics and physics. Yes. That has been really one of the highlights of this fantastic Russian tradition. And St. Petersburg has been also a place where there were lots of geometers, and Misha has been really raised in this environment. His thesis was definitely very geometric in spirit, but he was answering topological questions, as you know.
Yes.
But now, concerning America, as you know, the way he went to America was through a very special man, namely Jim Simons, who
yes.
caught him on his way to Israel to get to the U.S. And I still remember with, I mean, very, very vividly, the moment when Misha arrived at Stony Brook, where he was for several years. And we were getting faxes every day of a new theorem that he was telling people.
Yeah.
As you know, he worked for some time in isolation and without any paper. So when he went out and started to tell everybody what he had in mind, it was just an amazing period where just basically every day there was a new stunning theorem coming up.
Yeah.
And it took us some years to fill in the details. But this has completely changed Riemannian geometry, as you very clearly explained.
Yeah. Oh.
This went on to other things, as you know. But
yes, yes. So very good. I'm sure that you gave a much better answer than Misha would have done himself. I'm very pleased with this because he's. I think he's also a modest person somehow, but not that modest. He's not shy. So there, now there was also something I have been thinking about. His work is characterized by extraordinary imagination and insight into the nature of mathematics. And I would have asked him, what is your secret? Have you any knowledge about this? Why do you think he has such an extraordinary imagination and insight into the nature of mathematics? Have you any ideas?
Well, it's a very tough question because definitely he's the only one who can really give a true answer.
Yeah.
What I realized talking with him over time is that basically for every single question, he's never interested in details. He wants really to get to the heart of the matter immediately. And that's why sometimes, as you know, when he attends a lecture, it can be tough on the speakers, because if the speaker is spending too much time on details, he gets frustrated and he really wants to get the true global picture very quickly. And I think his insistence on the really getting to really the basic things is something which certainly forces you to great leaps of imagination, because very often you cannot rely on anything which is a classical view. So on many, many issues, he had to come up with completely new views, as you very, very brilliantly explained. And how he went to this, to this attitude of really, being never satisfied if he doesn't get to the bottom of things, I don't know. He's really the only one who can answer that.
Yeah, that's right. So now it can be a combination also. What is your view of the future of mathematics? Do you have any idea what he's working on at the moment?
Well, I think I know, because he's finishing a very big paper on some kind of connection between finite and infinite combinatorics, but he will, I'm sure, say more on that. But as you know, in the last 10 years, he spent quite a very large amount of time talking to biologists and medical people. And at the moment, he's, for the Institute, pursuing with a small team here, but also in connection with medical doctors and also experimentalists in the U.S., a completely new program on what he calls the electrophysiological geometry of the heart. Yeah. And in a sense, he's not interested in the heart as a physical body, but strictly as some kind of a black box which can conduct electromagnetic waves, and therefore trying to reconstruct some kind of internal geometry of the heart purely from measurements from electrocardiograms. And really, this is mathematically an extremely challenging problem, because it's a three-dimensional inverse problem, which, as we know, are very hard. Already the two-dimensional ones are difficult. But also because the measurements you can make in this setting are, first of all, not that many compared to measurements you can do usually in physical experiments, but also very undefined, very, very badly defined, because of course when you measure with the electrocardiogram, you're never sure you are at what distance you are of the heart itself. But nevertheless, he's taken up the challenge, which is a very risky thing, and we are developing some activity in this area.
Yes, that's very good, and I think we have got a lot more insight also in what he's doing. So I'll thank you very much, Jean-Pierre, for giving us this further information, and congratulations, of course, first of all, naturally, to Misha Gromov, but certainly also very congratulations to your department, which I know have a lot of brilliant mathematicians in there. So thank you very much, Jean-Pierre.
Thank you, Vaughan. For us, it's a great honor that Misha receives the Abel Prize, and certainly I enjoyed very much listening to your fantastic lecture. Okay. My pleasure talking to you.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Well, then it remains for me only to thank the audience and for coming, and wish you welcome to the prize ceremony in the old Gamle Logen on Tuesday, the 19th of May at 2 o'clock. So the winner will receive the prize from His Majesty King Harald, and Her Majesty Queen Sonja will also be present during the ceremony. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.